and welcome to our ceremony this afternoon. It's delightful to see you all here. Could I ask if you have a mobile phone with you that you could turn that off? And now I would ask that you stand for the entrance of the official party and join with singing the school hymn.
Ask you to please be seated. We are assembled here to commend to Almighty God the seniors of the school and those appointed as senior preachers and prefects for 2015 as they prepare to exercise the office to which we have called them in our school community. Let us start by saying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us draw near to God and hear God's word.
The reading is from the Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 6, verses 12 to 16. Wisdom is radiant and unfading, and she is easily discerned by those who love her and is found by those who seek her. She hastens to make herself known to those who desire her. One who rises early to seek her will have no difficulty, for she will be found sitting at the gate. To fix one's thought on her is perfect understanding, and one who is vigilant on her account will soon be free from care. Because she goes about seeking those worthy of her, and she graciously appears to them in their paths and meets them in every thought. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Could I ask our seniors to please stand? Grade 12 for 2015. Your child. As seniors of the school, you are called to be school leaders. Younger students will look up to you and follow your example. Do you promise, in the presence of God and those assembled here, to wear the uniform with pride, to set a good example for the other girls to emulate, and to follow in the footsteps of Jesus and St. Hilda, to care for others and help them to do their best? If I could ask the seniors to please move to the side, and I'll hand over to Mrs. Broder, who's going to present.
Ladies and gentlemen and members of the school community, this kind of takes a little while, so I would appreciate your patience, and if you could hold your applause until the end. So this is the senior class of 2015. Mimi Ahrens. Madeline Aegis. Zara Ahmed. Michaela Alder. Amelia Batty. Charlie Borden, prefect with the portfolio of academic and creative ideas and athletics co-captain. Isabella Bailey. Charlotte Birch. Amy Boardman. Bridget Boston. Grace Branch, prefect with the portfolio of student committees and swimming co-captain, who is just out of bed after having an operation yesterday. Jasmine Britton. Matilda Brown, prefect with the portfolio of non-Novus Solum and softball co-captain. Bianca Bruce, athletics co-captain and cross-country co-captain. Olivia Burden, cross-country co-captain. Bridget Burton, prefect with the portfolio of non-Novus Solum and rhythmic gymnastics captain. Laura Bircher, in absentia. Kate Christopher. Charlie Churchill. Phoebe Close-Innes. Alessandra Colombini in absentia, Isabella Coleman, Jane Considine, softball co-captain, Phoebe Considine, tennis co-captain, Jessica Crawford, Madeline Crooks. Claudia Cross. Caitlin Denison, Prefect with the Portfolio of Student Committees. Harriet Dignan, Carragaroo House Sports Captain. Madison Dinsmore. Ali Donald, Prefect with the Portfolio of Chapel and Netball Co-Captain. Alexandra Douglas, Prefect with the Portfolio of Academic and Creative Ideas and Music Co-Captain. Sabrina Durante. Amber Dwinell, Prefect with the Portfolio of Non-Novus Solum. Mackenzie Edmonds. Brooke Eglinton. Nina Ead, Carragaroo House Captain. Hannah Ellis. Della Evans. Esther Fiorini. Georgia Frank. Georgia Frizzell, school captain. Monique Fullerton Smith. Kay Fung. Matilda G, Malaluka House Sports Captain. Isabel Goddard. Michelle Galotta. Madeline Hall, Prefect with the Portfolio of Student Voice. Mackenzie Hall. Kiara Halpin. Ambrosine Hartle, hockey co-captain. Taylor Hassel in absentia. Holly Hitson, Prefect with the Portfolio of Boarding and Basketball Co-Captain. Ashley Hutchinson. Judith Hutchison-Strachan. Connor Irie, Prefect with the Portfolio of Student Voice and Debating Co-Captain. Georgia Jack. Emily Jamison. Kylie Jarvis, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sport and Touch Co-Captain. Nicolette Johansson, Prefect with the Portfolio of Student Voice. Alex Jones, Rowing Co-Captain. Sarah Jones. Candice Collado. Amen Karim in absentia. Alexandra Kamoskaya, Prefect with the Portfolio Chapel and Football Co-Captain. Dai Kim. Amelia King. Ashling Knox, Head Day Girl. Sophie Kuhneman. Doris Lau in absentia. Ilana Lever, Badminton Co-Captain and Football Co-Captain. Kate Lee. Tegan Loom, Malaluka House Captain. Montana Lescu, Prefect with the Portfolio of Diversity and Touch Co-Captain. Jonty Lester, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sport. Phoebe Lockyer. Chloe Lowe, Prefect with the Portfolio of Boarding. Shay Marnie, Prefect with the Portfolio of Cultural Arts and Music Co-Captain. Kate McAdam. Kate McCotter. Tiffany McGeary, Prefect with the Portfolio of Boarding. Amy McElroy, Banksia House Captain. Lauren McLeish, Head Boarder. Persephone Mead Small, Prefect with the Portfolio of Academic and Creative Ideas. Chelsea McKeska, Artistic Gymnastics Captain. Madeline Miller. Lana Monaghy. Brianna Moore, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sport and Basketball Co-Captain. Julia Morahan, Golf Captain. Peter Morton, Prefect with the Portfolio of Cultural Arts and Debating Co-Captain. Imogen Mulcahy. Grace Murray. Kimmy Nam, Prefect with the Portfolio of Diversity. Lydia Narodetsky. Magenta Neath Cowan, Prefect with the Portfolio of Cultural Arts and Drama Co-Captain. Annabelle Nichols, Prefect with the Portfolio of Student Committees. Zeldine Pete. Alina Pepeleva, in absentia. Christy Perrin, Prefect with the Portfolio of Chapel, Drama Co-Captain and Volleyball Co-Captain. Emily Popoff. Brogan Press. Keely Press in absentia, Stephanie Purser. Chloe Robinson. Sarah Robinson, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sustainability. Naoka Salmon, Netball Co-Captain. Georgia Sartor, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sustainability and Hockey Co-Captain. Georgia Saunders. Lucia Schultz. Julian Scott. Lily Seddon. Courtney Segrin Parenti, Cattle Club Captain. Naib Shah. Michaela Simpson. Kelsey Skeynes. Madison Smith, Prefect with the Portfolio of Diversity and Rowing Co-Captain. Georgia Solway. Grace Stanley. Tamara Stanley, Tennis Co-Captain. Sophia Stewart. Madeline Storrs. Alice Stewart. Kate Taylor, School Sports Captain. Brooke Toomey, Equestrian Captain. Isabella Tremaine, Prefect with the Portfolio of Sustainability and Badminton Co-Captain. Bridget Watson. Jessica White. Megan Whitelaw. Brittany Whitmore. Isabella Whittingham. Nicole Wilde, Music Co-Captain. Georgia Williamson. Dodie Wilson, Banksia House Sports Captain. Finlay Yeda. Maritza Zantiotis. Ladies and gentlemen, the senior class of 2015.
If I could ask you to please stand as we sing together the hymn, Sister, Brother, Let Me Serve You. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Today, what I would like to talk to you about is wisdom in connection to the idea of leadership. To clarify to start with, of course, wisdom does not make you a leader. In fact, you can be a terrific leader and be appallingly unwise. Because in a very simplistic and narrowed down sense, leadership is simply the ability to get people to follow you. You might use charisma to encourage people to accept your vision, your way of acting, and to follow your dream, which is fine, unless your vision is foolish, or worse, harmful and hateful. You see, some people will bow to a charismatic leader without thinking about the vision and where it leads. As a leader, you might make use of institutional authority, which is the type of authority that the prefects are entrusted with at this time of year. Some people sadly use their institutionally granted leadership for their own ends, to make themselves feel better or stronger, and because the institution says to follow their lead. Others are required to do so. Some people will even use fear and intimidation to have others do things their way. That kind of behavior is simply bullying. I believe it cheapens the word leadership and the ideas associated with it. Frankly, I hope none of you would have anything to do with that. More often, though, leaders are chosen because they have that something special, which includes but isn't limited to desire to serve, the ability to organize, to gather people together, the capacity to see how things might be better, and the drive to make them better. Not merely as individuals, but as a group. To those chosen as leaders, please try and live up to that trust. So now to wisdom. Because whilst you don't need wisdom to be a leader, it sure wouldn't hurt to have some. The scripture passage Mrs. Broder read for us gives us a picture of wisdom from God's perspective. And I think the core of that passage is simply this. That is, if you wish to be wise, you can take steps along that path. And when I say if you wish something, think about the steps that people take to get tickets to their favorite band. Cast your mind back to Harry Styles and One Direction when they were at the top, Or perhaps your parents and grandparents, when the Beatles came to Australia, you may have seen Vision on TV. That gives you a bit of a picture, perhaps. Or something more personal, when you set yourself a goal, a career, a vision of your future, and you choose to invest yourself in that, that's the same as setting yourself as one of your life goals, to be wise. So what is wisdom? This idea that we can work towards. I think it has three dominant components to be true godly wisdom. The first two are applied intelligence and experience. I think you need experience because it's the material you work with to create wisdom. Picture an amazing supercomputer with a fantastic processor that can run any software you can think of as quickly and smoothly as you want. That's the intelligence, if you will. But without software, without something to work with, well, then there's nothing it can really do. That software, those memories that we absorb, are the experiences we need to create wisdom. What about godly wisdom, though? See, wisdom is the application of knowledge and intellectual cleverness. Godly wisdom is the way is the application of that knowledge and intellectual cleverness in a way that is loving. In a way that asks the question, what is the most loving thing to do? And it is therefore the application of experience and intelligence in a way that is beneficial to all. And that, I believe, is why wisdom will make your role as leaders in this school so much more powerful. You will have experiences and you will continue to accumulate them. You are all intelligent enough to think about and apply those experiences to future circumstances. And if you can make those applications with care and concern for all involved, with love and compassion, then you will be great and wise and leaders. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen. We come now to the blessing and the dedication of the badges. These badges be blessed, and may those who wear them lead with wisdom and generosity. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. For the induction of the senior prefects and the prefects, could I please ask those to stand, the senior prefects and prefects. We as a school charge you to realize that you have been called to a position of service, dignity, and responsibility. You are to use your position with wisdom and care, remembering always that you are entrusted with it for the glory of God and the honor of your school. See to it that by your attitudes and behavior, you set an example of Christian love and service. Do you promise, in the presence of God and those here assembled, to strive to fulfill these things? If I could ask the prefects to sit and the senior prefects to remain standing.
Georgia Frizzell, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of senior prefect and school captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Aisling Knox, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Head Day Girl. May the blessing of God be upon you. wear this badge with pride and honour. Lauren McLeish, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Head Boarder. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Kate Taylor, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and School Sports Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Amy McElroy, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Banksia House Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Ina Nee, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Karagaroo House Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Tegan Murn, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Melaleuca House Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. And at this stage, if I can call to the stage the president of the OGA, this is Debbie Buckley. It's tradition within the school that the badges of the senior sports, the house sports captains be pinned by the president of the OGA. So we're delighted to have Mrs. Buckley with us and to be doing that very traditional act of the sports captain. Dodie Wilson, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Banksia Sports Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Harriet Dignan, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Karagaroo Sports Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Matilda G, I grant you the authority to exercise the office of Senior Prefect and Melaleuca Sports Captain. May the blessing of God be upon you. And wear this badge with pride and honour. Thank you, Mrs. Buckman. Now, the prefects holding a portfolio, if the prefects would move forward. I understand you're coming on stage, is it right? While the badges are being handed out, and girls, as I'm sure we can squeeze onto stage with some sense of equity. This is new strategy. That's great. And to the collective group, if I'm afraid if the girls on the end, if we can perhaps turn and face the school. I grant you the authority to exercise the office of prefect. May the blessing of God be upon you. Wear this badge with pride and honour. Thank you, girls. It's not that often we get this group so silent, so it's really a delight to our ears. To the Year 12s, if you would stand and face the school, please. Members of St Hilda's School, I charge you to receive those who have now been inducted as senior prefects, prefects and seniors for 2015, and to give them your cooperation and loyalty. This is where we look at the screen, I think, and we say what's on the screen. We. I think we marked it, but we'll be up better now. We. Thank you very much. Very traditional and very wonderful. Thank you. Take a seat, girls.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we give you our hands to do your work. We give you our feet to go your way. We give you our eyes to see as you do. We give you our tongues to speak your words. We give you our minds that you may think in us. We give you our spirit that you may pray in us. Above all, we give you our hearts that you may love through us. We give you our whole self that you may grow in us, so that you, Lord Jesus, who lives and works in us and prays in us. Amen.
We pray for the senior prefects, house captains, prefects and seniors of the school. May your Holy Spirit direct them at all times in the carrying out of their duties. Fill their hearts with loyalty, courage, patience, and love, so that in all things they may seek your glory and the well-being of this school. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Can I start by welcoming the six girls from last year? It's lovely to see you back here, and for the presentation of your academic awards a little later in the assembly. Also, Mrs. Debbie Buckley, the president of the LGA, who I noticed has snuck in amongst the young old girls, and feeling very hip, I guess, but I guess the use of the word hip isn't at all cool, so I'll be reprimanded on that later. But nonetheless, it's lovely to see you here, and to the parents and grandparents who have joined us, it's lovely to turn this into a wonderful family occasion that it genuinely is. Well, congratulations to the girls of 2015. We've been looking forward to your rising to the top of the school, and your moment has arrived. And it is a moment indeed, and it's a moment to treat as a special part of life. I think everyone who has graduated school remembers the time when they made the final year, and it is an opportunity to do something significant with your school years as they start to come to a close. This topic of leadership is one of the harder topics to grapple with. It's one that we all struggle with, and you will hear amongst the wisdom told to you a combination of wit and wisdom and also complete silliness. It is one of those topics that some people admire the worst possible characteristics of others. It is one of those topics where it only brings shame to the heart as you ponder why has that person made it. Why is that person regarded as a leader, and why are people following? It's one of those issues that as a community we just evolve and think about over and over again. We usually put someone of significance in front of you as a significant leader, and I'm going to use two quick examples. One is Mahatma Gandhi, who was critical in the independence of India in 1949, but his work really started probably 25, 30 years earlier. The second is Mandela. Both of these people had some characteristics that I think are extraordinary and can show the way for everyone at whatever stage of leadership journey they're on. I think Gandhi's extraordinary moment of leadership started after the Amritsar massacre, which is a massacre that, when I read about it in the history book, still chills me. It chills me because of its brutality. It chills me because of the appalling nature of those who committed it. In essence, a peaceful march in Amritsar was greeted by machine gunning of the British troops. They say they killed only 350, but better estimates are of 1,000, and you really don't understand the horror of that occasion unless you see photographs of the site or go and visit it. And when you see it, what you notice is that they pointed their machine guns at the exit points, which were narrow laneways, and they machine gunned those who were running out of the area down the laneways. It's a chilling moment when you see what they did. Mandela's story is well known. Mandela spent many years on Robben Island, just off Cape Town, and he spent it in jail. The persecution was obvious, the deprivation of liberty was obvious. But what's extraordinary about that man is the way in which he responded, both while he was there and while he was after he was released. When he was released, he started what they called the peace and reconciliation process. That peace and reconciliation process was extraordinary and very similar to Gandhi's response to the Amritsar massacre. Gandhi, with the Amritsar massacre, didn't rail and bring revolution upon his enemies. While I guess he must have felt some right to want to smite all those who had committed the crimes against his people, as Mandela must have felt the right to commit vengeance against those who had been his enemies, both men took a path road of peace, and while some would say that was weakness, I would suggest to you that was absolute strength. Extraordinary strength. Because they had to get control of their emotion. They had to get control of the injustice. They had to get control of the righteousness that was theirs to muster everyone to defeat the enemies who were so obvious. But they chose instead a much more powerful pathway. They chose, in the case of Gandhi, to suggest to people the best way to protest was peaceful protest, to sit down, to watch, to simply not cooperate. And in Mandela's case, the extraordinary, extraordinary forgiveness that he granted people. He basically said, admit your crime and I will forgive you. And a lot of people would say, where's the satisfaction in that? But I would suggest the power in it was phenomenal. When we look at leadership, we look at a very complex set of events. We look at your personality, we look at your capacity, and we look at the opportunity before you. As I look at our group of 2015 year 12s, the entire group, what I know is that our leadership goes way deeper than this group here, or the group of prefects in the front rows. It is right through the year group. That must have been a key point. This opportunity is now is to have that come out and be used. Because one of the things that I know about leadership that is the ultimacy of crime against it is for us as individuals to choose not to use it. Because what I see when I see people who choose not to use the leadership that they are given and the opportunities that they have, not to use their personality, not to use their capacity, I never see anything other than the start of a life of thwarted character and ultimately, I believe, bitterness. Because it seems to me that those people who have the capacity and choose not to use it become the smarties at the back of the office. They become the unhelpful. They become people with insight. But because they refuse to use it, their own personality shrivels. Leadership is an opportunity, and I simply say to you, do not let it pass by. As I also think about leadership for us in our school, I think every one of us here should look at these young women, the whole group, and ask, what do we want from their leadership? Last year, when we asked the girls to present for senior leadership, we didn't ask them to present what they could do. We asked them, what would we get from their leadership? It's an interesting twist on the question. It's a selfish moment, which I hope every one of you have asked. So, you look at them, and what do we get? What are we going to get from them? And I think it is right for us to have expectations. I think it is right for us to want something for us. And I'm going to suggest that I expect them to believe in something. I expect them to do something when they have the opportunity. And I expect that they will do it with style. These are old-fashioned words, style. In the old days, they would have said charm. And then charm fell out of fashion as we wondered whether charm was a sexist term. I surveyed the girls a few years ago on that issue. Did they think boys could have charm? Universally, they said yes. I think they can. Charm is something that humanity can share. Because what I believe is that as we expect them to believe in something and to do something, we expect a certain manner about it. I don't expect a bully. I don't expect to be shoved around. I have high expectations on the style with which they will operate. There was a writer in America, Mr. Powell will place up the slide, Cal Newport. Cal Newport is writing some interesting things at the moment. And he is writing, he has created a phrase that I think has meaning for us all, which is simply, be as good, be so good, they can't ignore you. Be so good, they can't ignore you. And I think it has a resonance for every one of us, not just those who are in 2015 as the leaders of the school. Be so good, they can't ignore you. Because what it says to everyone is do something, build your personality, build your capacity, take the opportunities, believe in something, and style and grace matter. In our school values, we put up there love, compassion, forgiveness, hope and grace. And on the new building, it will be up in massive letters and imprinted on the side of that building in a way none of you will miss. Love, compassion, forgiveness, hope and grace. The hardest of all to explain to you is grace. And one of the most powerful there is grace. Because as you think about your leadership, as you grow your leadership, and as you develop as a year group, the grace is about how you respond and how you mature. And the grace is your choice to give. And you choose to give it, or you choose not to. And I sincerely hope, as you think about how your personality, your capacity, your opportunity, you'll mimic the Gandhi and the Mandela. You'll take the sense of what they offered the world that was way beyond their nations, and right at the heart of inspiration about humanity. And you will understand that it's what you do and how you do it.
Afternoon. This section of the ceremony celebrates the achievements of the graduates of 2014. Some interesting academic facts about this year group that should be celebrated. 4 students achieved an OP1. 33% of the OP eligible students received an OP1 to 5. 70% of OP eligible students achieved an OP of 1 to 10. 94% of students achieved an OP 1 to 15 or equivalent. 98% of the students received an offer for a tertiary education from QTAC. 86 6% of the students receive their first or second preference. On the plaques and certificates to be presented are Latin phrases that refers to the students' achievements. Summa cum laude, with highest honour, will be given to our OP1 students. Magna cum laude, with great honour, will be presented to our OP students. And cum laude, which means with honour, will have certificates presented to our OP3 students. In absentia, the St Hilda School acknowledges the following students: OP1 recipients Leilani Horty Banks, Daisy Lee; OP2 recipients Amanda Torba, Abby Bayless, Sherry Zhang, Savannah Zhang; OP3 recipients Camille Chen and Jessica Tan. Mr. Crawley would like to acknowledge the following students: Holly Brown, who achieved an OP3 and was offered a Bachelor of Arts at the University of Queensland. Isabel Tall achieved an OP3 and was offered a place in a Bachelor of Commerce and Bachelor of Arts at the University of Queensland. Stephanie Gartia, who achieved an OP3 and was offered a place in Bachelor of Biomedical Science with honours at Griffith University. Savannah Smith, who achieved an OP2 and was offered a place in the Bachelor of Science at the University of Queensland. I'm going to break from script here because two students snuck in late. Abby Bayless, who received an OP2. I don't quite have what you're offered at this point in time. So can we welcome Abby? Daisy Lee, who achieved an OP1 and was offered a place in the Bachelor of Medical Science at Griffith University. Meg Sanderman, who achieved an OP1 and was offered a place in the Bachelor of Medical Science at Griffith University. And Lisa Ogie, who achieved an OP1 and was offered a place in the Bachelor of Vision Science and Master of Optometry at QUT. Can we once again congratulate these students on their fantastic achievements?
Mr. Crawley, distinguished guests, parents, special friends, teachers and students, and welcome to the 2015 Senior Induction and First Assembly of the Year. I'd just like to start off by saying what an honour and privilege it is for me to have been chosen to lead the hundreds of St Hilda's girls who will be the empowered and forward-thinking young women of tomorrow. Young women who will draw on their privileged education, seize their opportunities and change the world. For this is our time, and this is our calling. We pursue such bold notions with a purpose that goes beyond ourselves, that speaks of something bigger than us. Non nobis solum, not for ourselves alone. In the 103-year history of our school, that simple Latin phrase has faithfully preached the benefits to society that can spring from our own successes when the posture of our heart is turned towards others. But more importantly, it also speaks of fostering a sense of community and school pride that should resonate with everyone who walks through our gates, from the freshest faces to those preparing to embark on the next phase of their educational journey. It is a statement that marries perfectly with the more contemporary School Foundation motto, which describes St Hilda's School as a place where girls can come to dream and to achieve. To truly flourish, girls need an environment where they feel supported, encouraged and empowered to pursue such ideals, a place where they are not afraid to push themselves beyond the boundaries of what they thought possible. This is such a place. I am fascinated by the world of human DNA and how it shapes our lives. When you delve into its intricacies and attempt to fathom its complexity, there is a profound message of hope and encouragement buried within the numbers. It is a message that helped shape my speech today and inspire my policy for the year ahead. Did you know that there are over 70 billion different possible human DNA combinations, and yet 99.94% of our DNA is exactly the same? So when you think about that literally, the only difference between you and I, or you and Miranda Kerr or Barack Obama, is 0.06% of you. I found this fact truly astounding. We have an enormous amount in common, yes, but it is this tiny fraction of differences that separate us and provide us all with the capacity to stand out in our own right. So we all need to strive to harness the power of our entire 0.06% to achieve our full potential. My appeal to you is such: be authentic. Be the most unique you that you can be. Make the most of your differences. Celebrate them. There is only one you, so embrace it. There is one thing that sets the world's most influential or inspirational leaders apart from the rest of society. They embrace the full extent of their 0.06%. They sought not to copy the creativity of others or steal ideas and concepts, but walked the road less traveled, created pathways where there was impasse, made light where there was darkness, pushed through their own personal boundaries and the conformity of the world, and disrupted the norm. Fiona Wood is one such inspiration. The former Australian of the Year and acclaimed birth specialist led a team of doctors credited with saving the lives of many badly burned victims of the 2002 Bali bombings through the use of her revolutionary spray-on skin. Dr. Wood developed the world's first advancement in burns treatment, which would not only reduce the scarring from the trauma, but also the time it took for the skin to heal. She and a colleague pioneered this breakthrough after receiving a schoolteacher patient who had received 90% burns to his body in a petrol fire. Fiona Wood proves that even in challenging circumstances, all of us are capable of pushing our personal limits and reaching new heights. It only took 0.06% of her to change the world. Champion hurdler Sally Pearson may not have saved lives, but her story is nonetheless another fine example of what can be achieved if one stubbornly sets their mind to being the greatest in their chosen field. Born not into wealth and elite status, Pearson was instead raised as a sole child to a single mum who battled to pay the bills. There was no car in Sally's household. Her mum had to work two jobs and weekends to pay for her athletics coaching, and she had to catch two buses from school to training each day. Wealth is no determinant to success, but determination is. The focused ability to build on talent is. Developing that 0.06% of your unique self is. From a hungry teenager with a fierce competitive streak and an unbowed commitment to train, an Olympian arose. A world beater emerged. We should not be overawed by such accomplishment, but rather motivated and inspired. For the pathway to greatness that lays before us as we charge into 2015 is open and clear, albeit narrow and requiring focus. Similar feats are entirely achievable if we dare. I believe that we can set new benchmarks in all areas of the school, whether it be in academics, cultural, sport, or in spirit. As a school, it is imperative that we work together and act as one, while importantly, still maintaining our own individuality and our special characteristics, our 0.06%. So there are three key messages that encapsulate my policy for 2015. The first of which is a word that features in our own mission statement, a word with tremendous power and potential of use wholeheartedly: love. Love encompasses a gamut of emotions and connotations, but for St Hilda's School in 2015, I want us to strive to love our school, to love learning, whether it is in the classroom or on the sporting field. As the famous saying suggests, if you're the smartest person in the room, then find another room. Because yes, it is true that we should never stop or should never want to stop learning. We should also love the fact that we are all extremely lucky and privileged to not only have the right to an education, but to have an education here, at St Hilda's School, at a school that is paving the way in education technology and pushing girls to dream and to achieve. We ought to love our school and family and be proud of it. Secondly, another attitude that I believe is imperative to making our school the best it can be in its 103rd year is respect. If you look at the word, respect is literally respect, meaning we should give people a second chance, take another look. We don't always know people's story. Instead of judgment and condemnation, we can choose to have fresh eyes, to use our words and deeds to help other women grow, heal, learn, and feel empowered, rather than using them to tear each other down. As women and leaders of the future, we need to be the ones who support and build each other women up. As the girls sitting in this room, right next to you today, in your class, are the advocates for a better tomorrow. Don't be offended by petty things like schoolyard gossip, unhealthy competition, or jealousy. Don't even give those trivial things any air to breathe. Instead, let's be offended by our own selves if we dare embrace an attitude that settles for underachievement, of taking the easy road, of not developing our 0.06% in order to make a difference in this world. And thirdly, a call to arms. Make your mark. As I'm sure many of you, like me, watched The Invitation Game during the holidays. One quote stood out for me in particular, acting as a reminder that greatness can reside in all of us if we each squeeze out every ounce of our potential. Sometimes it is the people who no one imagines anything of who do the things that no one can imagine. Or perhaps a bit more comically, so says Dr. Seuss, today you are you, that is truer than true. There is no one alive who is youer than you. Embrace it. You're all extraordinary. Go and show the world. So as a new school year beckons, let us all make a firm commitment to reach our full potential, to be the Fiona Woodses and Sally Pearsons of tomorrow, to leave your personal imprint on this ever-evolving world. Every woman in this room today should feel empowered to make a difference, not just because of your own unique ability and skill set, but because there are incredible women around you, sitting next to you today, in your classroom, in your team, willing you on, championing your cause. A famous quote of unknown origins says that, your life won't ever be perfect, but it can be purposeful. Live for something bigger than yourself and leave a mark on the world. For this is our time and this is our calling. Thank you.
Together the school prayer. Almighty God, from whom comes every good and perfect gift, send down your blessing, we pray, upon the school. Teach us to live together in love and joy and peace. In our work, give us the spirit of understanding and perseverance. In our games, true sportsmanship. And in our prayers, the power to draw near to you. Let the spirit of devotion and loyalty bind us all more closely together, so that we may labour not only for our own advantage, but also for the common good, through him who loved us and gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we could stand for the blessing. May the gift of leadership awaken in you as a vocation, keeping you mindful of the call you have to serve. As high over the mountains the eagle spreads its wings, may your perspective be larger than the view from the foothills. When the way is flat and dull in times of grave, may your imagination continue to evoke horizons. In your heart, may there be a sanctuary for the stillness where clarity is born. May your work be infused with passion and creativity, and have the wisdom to balance compassion and challenge. May you welcome your own vulnerability as the ground where healing and truth join. May the integrity of soul be your first ideal, the source that will guide and bless your work. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Before we sing our final hymn, in the sheets, Mr. Crawley has invited parents, guests, and Year 12 students to join him for afternoon tea in Bearfield. So please feel welcome to join us for that. Our final hymn is the Sun Blessing.